the forests of planet Earth. A celebration of diversity. What we refer to as woodland nowadays is often man-made commercial forest. Yet the forests can be so much more. In various climate zones, it overcomes significant challenges in surprising and fascinating ways. From the northern forests of the Arctic Circle to tropical jungles. From coastal forests steeped in salt water to the forests of the rugged mountain slopes. These are the forests of our planet. The forest is like a living organism, ancient and full of hidden networks. Its vegetation needs water and specific temperatures. Despite the challenges, however, it manages to survive in the most varied locations on Earth. How does it manage to adapt, even in adverse conditions? Coexistence in the woods is a symbiosis. The trees depend on the animals, and many animals depend on the trees. The great significance of the forest has always led humankind to mystify it. The northern forest of Scandinavia. For 7 months a year, the temperatures are below freezing here, yet the trees survive. It seems like the cold doesn't affect the forest much, for good reason. As one approaches the poles, the animals of a species become larger. In warmer regions, they're smaller, like moose, for example. In northern Sweden, they're noticeably bigger than in the south. It's a simple trick. The larger the volume of an animal in relation to its body surface, the more warmth it can conserve. Volume saves warmth, while surface area releases it. With trees, however, things are different. Thick trunks would, of course, be better suited to conserving body warmth, but trees don't produce warmth and are therefore dependent on air temperature. Besides, their growth actually uses up valuable energy and time, both of which are in short supply. The polar summer, when they can grow, is short, and the time when they are free of frost is also restricted. But this is when they must produce high energy sugar solution from water. They have to economize on their energy, as well as growing and reproducing within the shortest time period. That's why trees get smaller and smaller the further north they appear. Winter temperatures impose a natural boundary on the forest, the tree line. Water is only available here for 5 months a year in liquid form. But woodland still thrives. The trees can only survive thanks to a kind of hibernation. The trunks are filled with veins. Some of them carry sugar solution from the leaves to the roots. Others supply the leaves and needles with water from the roots upwards. The energy-rich sugar allows the tree to grow. When it gets too cold, deciduous trees shed their leaves. They do not require any more water to produce sugar solution. The tree ceases to supply water, and the stream of sugar solution is halted, acting like protective antifreeze. In addition, the tree is insulated by an air cushion between the trunk and the outer bark, unless the sun comes out. While on the sunny side, the cells of the tree warm up and begin to expand, the shaded side remains frozen stiff. Pressure builds in the trunk, finally becoming too much. The crack is a gateway for diseases and fungus. Not every tree can survive such damage. As long as snow is lying on the treetops, they're guarded against rupture. It acts as insulation against wind and extreme cold. In the hollows beneath the snow layer, temperatures can even climb above zero. Abandoned by the plants, animals are left to scavenge as best they can in winter. Red deer search out the last patches of grass. If the snow cover is too high, they're left with only bark. This is not substantial enough, and the animal's health suffers. Those who can find lichen are better off. Reindeer have adapted, and so are able to gather high-energy food like this. Further east, in Siberia, a puzzling creature lives from lichen, even if its teeth look more suitable for other diets. Musk deer. Their sharp canine teeth serve more as defensive weapons. Forest dwellers have to possess special talents in order to survive. The capercaillie has resorted to eating entire fir tree shoots. Its thick plumage protects it from the cold. 1 pound of fir sprigs a day is enough for it to get by. Deciduous trees become fewer the further north the northern forest reaches, or the higher up the mountain forest stretches. The last trees left are mostly coniferous. This is because the cold persists longer in these areas. But it's not the low temperatures that challenge the trees, rather the lack of moisture. Water only exists in the form of snow and ice. Even the water in the ground is frozen and therefore unattainable for the trees, as the roots cannot take it up. That's a major problem for deciduous trees. Water is constantly evaporating through the thin leaves that are mostly dried out by the wind, which is why they shed their foliage when it gets too cold. In some polar regions and areas of high altitude, the warm periods are so short that it's not worth forming leaves. Too little energy would be left over to grow and maintain a large tree. In order to survive here, the forest needs a strategy. Needle-like leaves. They lose next to no water in the wind, as their surface area is smaller and their skin thicker. Some species also offer extra protection for their needles with a layer of wax. This is how the conifer trees get through the winter, by relying on the water supplies from the previous summer. The advantage is obvious. In spring, valuable energy does not have to be invested in forming new leaves. As soon as the water in the ground begins to melt, the tree can begin to produce nutritious sugar solution in its needles through photosynthesis. In this way, time is saved, and every minute of the short, polar or mountain summer is put to good use. Those not dependent only on a vegetable diet have an advantage in the forest. In winter, more animals perish than in any other season. Such a large carcass quickly attracts competition. The bear is put off by some superior forces, while the wolves make it very clear who's in charge around here. In the mountain forests of Spain, winter is often just as harsh as in the far north. Griffon vultures, crows, and ravens get stuck into a dead wild boar. Though thousands of kilometers apart, various forest dwellers undertake the same task. The forest offers niches for specialists, even in the coldest season. Life has almost come to a halt. The forest is in hibernation. But when the sun starts to shine stronger again, the forest begins to waken, drop by drop. And with the water comes life once again. Now roots can become saturated once more so that leaves and needles can soon produce their essential sugar solution. Coniferous trees and mosses immediately start photosynthesis, and beneath the snow, winter aconites and snowdrops lie waiting for their big chance. Within a few days, the forest is transformed into a paradise. Finally, the deciduous trees also begin to sprout. And so the circle is once again complete. All the pieces are in place, and the forest organism is renewed once more. Everything has its place here. Storks return to Europe in spring and settle into the top floor of the forest. In faraway Kamchatka, on the east coast of Russia, this position is taken by the Steller's sea eagle. It needs a high nesting platform for takeoff and landing. Its wingspan is almost 3 meters. smaller species can penetrate further into the forest. A hummingbird's nest in the Amazon. Birds all over the world are accommodated in arboreal lofts. One floor further down, mammals or marsupials have moved in. Koalas in Australia. In Africa, chimpanzees. Drills. And bonobos. Every evening, great apes like these gorillas build themselves a night nest from the branches, just as our own ancient ancestors must have done. And finally, in the trunk of the tree, even more animals find a spot. The only premise is that woodpeckers have to build the cavity themselves. They do indeed hammer a hole into the trunk, but the damage is limited. To build its breeding lair, the woodpecker mostly seeks out trees with rotten areas in their cores. First, the bird works its way through the bark. Underneath lies the bast, where cells transport sugar solution. The woodpecker recognizes the rotten part of the trunk by the sound of his tapping. At that point, the wood is softer. To get there, the bird often takes year-long breaks, allowing fungus to further soften the construction site. As he hammers on, he reaches the sapwood. Here, water is transported from the roots to the leaves by living wood cells. Deeper into the tree, the bird reaches the heartwood. This only serves as support now, as these wood cells have already died. A few channels are indeed broken by the woodpecker's hole, but the majority of the lair is built within the dead heartwood. Round about the nesting hollow, water and sugar solution are still flowing, enough to keep supplying the tree with nutrition. The bird does not harm the tree. On the contrary, it helps to keep insects at bay that live off the wood. Well, and others. Once the woodpecker has completed its first construction and has moved away again, other animals are glad to make use of the living space over the following years. Flying squirrels, for example. They live in the forests of Finland. After a few years, even giants can take advantage of the hollowed-out trees. Black bears in North America. A mother has used the tree trunk as a birthing chamber for her cub. Former woodpecker cavities make desirable nurseries for common golden eyes, for instance. The nest protects them from ground predators, but also poses a problem. How do the chicks get back down? Their instincts tell them to follow their mother, no matter where she goes. Their bones are so flexible that they very seldom break. Much more dangerous than the fall is the stroll across the forest floor. Here, they're at the mercy of predators. Only once they reach the water are they safe from attack. Foxes, meanwhile, prefer life in the basement of the tree. Vixens like to build their dens between the roots. At first glance, the forest appears to profit animals most of all, offering them food and shelter. Yet this is a two-way transaction. Without the woodpecker, for example, insects under the bark could multiply unhindered. And the forest itself is even more dependent on animals to help it reproduce and expand, such as the squirrel. All kinds of stuff fall from the trees in autumn. Seeds of various types. And the animals help by spreading them far and wide. From chipmunks and mice to red squirrels and ants. Bodies of fat and sugar hang from many of the seeds, acting as a reward. Of course, the animals also consume some of the nuts. But many are ploughed in or buried. Beech trees have developed a special way of smuggling as many seeds as possible past the greedy animals. In some years, the trees produce so many beech nuts that the animals are full up long before they've eaten everything on offer, so many of the seeds can germinate in the animals' food stores. Fruit-bearing trees are especially geared towards gaining attention. With their juicy and often brightly coloured harvest, they easily attract their horticultural helpers. It's a strategy evolved over millions of years. When the cassowary swallows a whole piece of fruit in the Australian bush, the kernel is carried to another location, where it's excreted and can then begin to grow again. This is more or less also how it works with fruit eaten by uakaris in the Amazon, or indeed by all other animals the world over. One species, however, plays an especially important role in the development of the forests. The flying fox. They're nocturnal and head off in the search for food when the sun goes down. These strict vegetarians eat mostly fruit or nectar. Fox. Flying foxes are said to be responsible for the plantation of their own habitats. Researchers from the Australian Department of the Environment estimate that a single flying fox can distribute around 60,000 seeds per night. Even if only 0.1% of the seeds actually germinate, a single animal would still plant around 22,000 trees every year. One small job for a bat, one giant leap for the forest. The most important element for a forest's survival is water. Without water, there would be no trees. Of course, every life form needs it, but the vegetation in the forest uses water very differently from humans or animals. The forest actually produces its fuel from water. Every tree channels water from the roots to the leaves, where it's transformed into glucose, pure energy food. Almost as if humans could create gold from lead, except the sugar trick really does work. Leaf cells contain chlorophyll. This captures sunlight used to charge up the cell's electrons. The packaged energy is sufficient to then separate the water into hydrogen and oxygen. The hydrogen is combined with carbon dioxide in the air to form glucose, while the oxygen is a byproduct, escaping into the surrounding environment, luckily for us humans. The sugar solution is distributed throughout the entire tree by its veins. Most of it is channeled to the roots, where any unused solution is stored for times of shortage. So that there's always enough water, the roots saturate themselves whenever they can. During rainfall, some trees manage to take in up to 1,000 litres. Yet the tree has no muscles with which to suck the water up. This is where the so-called capillary effect comes in, by which water flows upwards in narrow tubes. This only works for the first metre, however. Then the tree has to change strategy. By vaporising water through the leaves, a suction effect is created in the veins that draws water upwards. In order to gain enough water for photosynthesis, the tree has to move large quantities. Around 500 litres flow through a large beech tree every day, and when the water escapes from the leaves, it rises up and falls over the forest again in the form of rain, a never-ending cycle. Water vaporization not only causes the typically damp forest climate, but also leads to evaporation chill. This is how the forest can cool itself and its surroundings by up to 2 degrees on hot summer days. An effect that benefits entire regions and their populations.